بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. We ask Allah azza wa jal to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge we have acquired and to raise our rank with the knowledge that we have acquired. Let everyone first have the proper intention in his heart to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also let everyone put the intention of i'tikaf in the mosque as long as he's in it for the sake of Allah. I'd like to give the reminder tonight about utilizing your perishing life in this world for the everlasting life in the hereafter. Because Allah Azza wa Jal in the Quran, in many verses, compared this life with the life of the hereafter. The whole Quran, when you read it, you see comparisons. Comparison between this life and the life of the hereafter. Comparison between the enjoyment of this life with the enjoyment of the hereafter. You see comparison between the state of the believers in this life and the state of the non-believers in this life. A comparison between the state of the believers in the hereafter and the state of the non-believers in the hereafter. Comparison between paradise and hell, between this world and in the hereafter. All these types of comparison you see in the Quran as you are reading the Quran to make you weigh things properly. So you make the right decision in the end. You do what is beneficial for you, what will take you to paradise, and you avoid what will take you to hellfire. Because paradise is a very precious matter. See, when you buy something that is very precious, it's very expensive, how you take care of it. In Arabic, it is called sila, sila meaning what you buy. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith, man khafa adlaj وَمَنْ أَدْلَجَ بَلَغَ الْمَنْزِلِ أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةٌ أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ الْجَنَّةِ مَنْ خَافَ أَدْلَج means the one who fears the darkness of the night will try to be home as early as he can before it becomes very dark, pitch black. And the one who starts his travel to his destination early, before darkness, he will reach his destination before darkness befalls him. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, indeed, the offer that Allah azza wa jal is offering his slaves is very precious, and this offer is paradise. What a great offer. It's worth it that you work for paradise, even if you want to eat a little, sleep a little, and utilize the rest of your time in acts of worship. That's why you see the righteous people in the past, those who understood life correctly, they abandoned all the worldly pleasures. To them, they meant nothing. And they made their focus the hereafter. The hereafter. And some Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon them the guidance since they were kids. Imam al-Nawawi, he died at a very young age, in 40s. But when he was a little kid, his friends used to ask him to come and play with them. He used to sit aside and cry. When they asked him, "Why you're crying?" he said, "We're not created for playing." He used to think. Allah Azza wa Jal guided him from that age. Now, if you see the books that Imam al-Nawawi authored, many books, you would say, how did he find time to author all these books in his lifespan? So if you were to divide his books over his lifespan, they exceed his lifespan. Allah Azza wa Jal blessed his time. Blessed his time. And he used to stay awake at night writing, authoring. And it is mentioned that when the lantern that he used to light up to see when he's writing, when it runs out of oil, so he can't see, that at some stages his finger would give light and he would be able to continue writing. Such a person understood life properly. And he worked for the hereafter. This life is short. The hereafter is everlasting. You know what fraction you would get. If you were to live up to 60, 70 years, if you were to put 60 years over non-ending years, what fraction you would have. This life is nothing compared to the hereafter. One of the scholars said, this life is like an hour. It's like an hour. Utilize it in obedience to Allah Azza wa Jal. For the self is greedy. Teach a lesson to be content. One's self is usually greedy. Now they say to someone, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if son of Adam were to be given a valley of gold, he will ask about the other valley. A valley of gold. So even if he were to spend that valley of gold to have pleasures in this life, he can do whatever he wants. And that would be enough. But still he will ask about the other valley. He's not content. He's not content. Greedy. Because this life is tempting. This life is very tempting. You live in this life and you think about the instant enjoyment. The enjoyment of this life is instant, meaning you get it now. You eat something that you enjoy, yeah, you can feel the enjoyment. So even if you are seeking pleasures from haram, yeah, that pleasure you are experiencing it now, as they say. Instant payback for this thing you are looking for in this world, the enjoyment you are looking for. Whether it is from haram or from halal, you see instant payback to you. That's mainly the rewards for the good deeds that you perform are deferred to the hereafter. Deferred to the hereafter. That's why, imagine people, let us say for instance, if they do an act of obedience, and after they finish the act of obedience, they can ask for something and they get it straight away. They ask for money, they get it. They ask for an enjoyment, they will get it. Yeah, you would see mosques full with people. But Allah Azza wa Jal, for a wisdom, deferred the repayment till the hereafter. So you get it in the hereafter. The one who is clever and smart will accept such an offer to work hard in this world and to get the reward in the hereafter. As Allah said in the Quran, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ حَرْثَ الْآخِرَةِ نَزِدْ لَهُ فِي حَرْثِهِ وَمَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ حَرْثَ الدُّنْيَا نُؤْتِهِ مِنْهَا وَمَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ نَصِيبِ. Such a beautiful verse. مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ حَرْثَ الْآخِرَةِ. If you are looking at the harvest in the hereafter, that's the harvest you're looking for. The one who is desiring the harvest of the hereafter, we will give him the reward for it. Not only that, نَزِدِ لَهُ فِي حَرْسِهِ, and will increase that harvest for him. So we'll give him. So he's working, he's doing the good deeds. In order to be rewarded in the hereafter, Allah will give him his rewards in full and extra. وَمَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ حَرْسَ الدُّنْيَا. If one is desiring the harvest of this world, he wants to reap an instant enjoyment, although it's perishing, quickly it perishes, but he's desiring the instant enjoyment that is perishing in this world, نُؤْتِهِ مِنْهَا. We'll give him whatever we predestined for him to get in this world. وَمَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ نَصِيبٍ. But on the day for judgment, he won't have a portion of that reward because he was working for dunya. Everything you work for dunya, you need to understand this clearly. Every minute, every effort you spend for this dunya, it's gone. It's gone. It's like you have money. You have money in your pocket. And some of your money, you put them in the toilet and you flush the toilet. That's it, gone. This dunya, whatever you do for it, will go. And that won't remain. But when you work for the hereafter, that what will remain. The work for the hereafter. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used to give to his wives the sustenance they need. So he wasn't short in providing his wives with the sustenance they need. But because they lived with the Prophet, the best of all the creations, and how lucky they were, subhanAllah, because of that, their hearts became attached with the hereafter, not this dunya. With the hereafter, not this dunya. So whatever they have, they would give to the poor. And they would be satisfied with very, very little amount of food. Aisha radiallahu anha mentioned that we never used to have twice a day a meal of barley bread. The barley, they make bread from it. It's different from the wheat. Now the wheat, it becomes smoother and the like. And even in the past, they used to, when they were asked, how do you do? You know the barley grain, it comes with that crust on top of it. It's enveloped with it. They crush them. And they all will be with them. Then they sift them as much as they can, blow on them, or the wind will take these things. And what will remain, they put water to it, they make them dough, and they bake them. That's what they eat. It's very different from the bread that you eat now. What you eat now is luxury compared to that one, the barley bread. Even that barley bread, that maybe now you won't eat it. Our Lady Aisha radiallahu anha said, we never used to have twice a meal of barley in one day. What does that mean? She said, if we were to have breakfast from the barley, then whatever we have left, we give them to the poor. That's it. Sometimes they miss the breakfast and they eat the meal in the afternoon. They used to have two meals, before noon and afternoon. That's it. Yani late afternoon. So when they have the one before noon, that's it. That went to the following day. If they miss that one, they eat the one in the afternoon. Although they have that food, but they offer it to others, to the poor, to the needy, because some even not have that loaf of bread that is made of barley even to that extent. So whatever the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam may get, he would give them, and they keep some, they donate the rest. Once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam brought to our Lady Aisha a full slaughtered sheep, slaughtered, full one. Aisha radiallahu anha, as she learned from the Prophet, started donating from that sheep. She donated the whole sheep except for an arm, because the Prophet used to like the arm of the sheep. She just kept the arm, one arm, and she donated the rest. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came back, he asked her what happened with the sheep. She said to him, all of it went except for the arm. Look at the word. She said, all of it went, meaning she donated that, except for the arm, meaning she kept the arm. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, Raza, all of it stayed except for the arm. Meaning what you donated, that what will you see in the hereafter. So it's not wasted. But what you eat and what you keep, that what will be wasted. But what you donated to the poor, that's what you see in the hereafter. Now you might say, but you know, we are living in this century, and we have to work, we have to get money, we have to do such and such and such. You see this as what? As a big burden. Trust me, if you give all your time to this dunya, your lifespan will end and you won't get what you were looking for. This is how the dunya is. Will keep you busy, 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 busy. It's like you're running after it, always. You know that caricature they show you, someone riding a donkey, and he has a bunch of grass wrapped with a stick, and he puts it where? He extended that thing in front of the head of the donkey. The donkey can see it at a distance, so he walk just to get it, but as he's walking, he's not getting it. The owner does this to keep that donkey what? Walking, moving. So he does it in this way. The donkey is following the grass. But in fact, he thinks, I'm going to get it. But in fact, that person that is riding the donkey is using this person. So that's the donkey. Don't be the donkey of this dunya. This dunya, if you were to chase it, will run away from you. It's like this donkey chasing the grass, and the grass is running away from him. This dunya, you run after it, will run away from you. Turn your back to it, she will chase you. The dunya will chase you. Because the dunya wants to tempt you. But if you are cautious and you turn your back away from this dunya, and you work for the hereafter, you see that the dunya is coming to your feet. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, the one whose concern is the hereafter, if your concern is the hereafter, keep that in mind. I want you to memorize it. The one whose concern is the hereafter, Allah will make his richness in his heart. His heart will be rich and will bring what he wants around him. And this dunya will come forcefully to him. But if one's concern is this dunya, Allah will make his poverty between his eyes. Between his eyes. And will keep what he's chasing away from him, scattered away. And he won't get from this dunya except what Allah predestined for him. So keeps running, running, running. That's why if your concern is the hereafter, you will see the dunya is coming to you. Trust me. Once you have that strong belief in your heart, I want to dedicate my time to the hereafter. You will see things coming to you easily. While others are working overtime to get what you are getting and they're not getting that. That's the blessings of working for the hereafter. I'll conclude by mentioning this story. It was mentioned that there was a princess living in a castle. And this one was pious, God-fearing one. Although she was living in a palace, in a luxury life, but that's not what she wants. She wants to live a very humble life. So this lady asked her maid, saying, "Go and ask in this village or kingdom of her father about the most pious young man. I want to marry him." So she went and she started asking from one place to another. Everyone, like unanimously agreed on a young man that was living in a cottage. Very, very, very small one. But he was very pious and very poor. She came back. She said, "I asked. I only found this young man. But he's very poor. Like very different, the life." She said, "I'm not looking for luxury in this life. That's what I want, piety." They brought him and she offered him to marry her. He said, "But I'm poor. I can't give you what you want. Not even what, in 1/100 or 1/1,000. He's very poor." She said, "I'm not looking for that. I want you for your piety. For your righteousness. That's all what I want. To live with you in a way that we fear Allah Azza wa Jal and we obey Allah." He accepted. She married him. He took her from the palace to that cottage. Poor. And he used to go from the morning after they pray, Fajr and the like. He used to go look for something to do, to get some money, to buy some food, to come at the end of the day with food to his wife. Basic food. Until one day he went out, spent all day trying to find something where he can buy food later. He couldn't. At around Maghrib time, he sat down and started crying. And he said, "Oh Allah, you know my heart is not attached to this world in any way. However, I have my wife who sacrificed the life in the palace for the sake to be with me. And she is fasting. And she wants some food to break her fast with. Oh Allah, give me something." So usually he wouldn't ask for this dunya, anything from it. But now he asked for the sake of his wife because she was fasting. Instantly, because he's a pious, righteous. He saw a big, massive piece of jewelry coming down. He was so happy with it. He took it and ran away to his house to tell his wife, so he can go and sell it, buy whatever they want. When he approached his wife with that piece of jewelry that he had, it's like a diamond, piece of diamond. She said, "Where did you get that from? I haven't seen such a beautiful piece of diamond in my whole life. Even with the treasure my father had, never seen something like this. What happened?" And he told her what happened. Do you know what did she say? She didn't say to him, "That's good, now we can make an upgrade. We can do whatever, whatever." No. She said to him, "Go back to that place where you got it. And ask Allah Azza wa Jal, saying, Oh Allah, if this is from what you have saved for us in the hereafter, I ask you to lift it. But if it's something separate, something as a reward in this life, keep it for us." So he went and he supplicated Allah. He said, "If this is something that you have saved for us in the hereafter, I ask you to make it raised into paradise. And if it's something as a reward in this life, to keep it." Instantly it was raised to paradise. He came back to his wife and she was so happy. She knew. That's called good tiding. Already she has seen by her eyes what's being prepared for them in the hereafter. If we can see what's being prepared in every good deed we do, trust me, we'll rush, compete to do good deeds in this life. But it's just because we can't see it. It's getting there, it's getting saved, hoarded for you. So it's like you make more savings. See how in this life you talk about how much you are saving in the bank. I have 50, I have 60, I have 70, I have 80. I want to make him 100, I want to make him 200, I want to make him a million. People talk about this. But save for the hereafter. Because your life is short. And I want you to think about this comparison. Your life here, the lifespan, which is 60, 70 average, in the hereafter everlasting. The enjoyment in this life that perishes quickly, the enjoyment of the hereafter that is everlasting. Make comparison, paradise, hell, all that, and you see that it's worth it to work for the akhirah while you are in this dunya. Barakallahu feekum, and Allah knows best.